Good morning. We're so glad that you've joined us from wherever you are. I don't know what your favorite part about gathering online is. Maybe it's that you can come to church in your pajamas, or that you can use your very special oat milk coffee creamer, or that you can comment with one another on Facebook right in the comment section right now, like over here, or down here, or over here. I don't know what your platform looks like, but I do know that church is so much more than a couple songs and a message. And even taking communion online together misses something. See, church is God's holy people gathered around the world on the firm foundation of who Jesus is. And something happens when we gather in person and open our lungs and our mouths and express together the goodness and the glory of God and declare who we are as His loved people. Something happens when we look each other in the eye, we speak the truth in love, we challenge one another, we encourage one another, and we leave here a little different. We leave here ready to live out the gospel, to unleash the gospel. Last week, we started a new series called Now What? We're making our way through the book of Acts. And what we noticed there is that the apostles, Jesus' followers, had to ask that question at every turn. Every time something changed, they asked, now what? What do we do now? And together as a church, we're asking that same question in the midst of this global crisis. We're asking ourselves at several points along this journey, now what? And what does it really mean to be the church? So this morning we'll continue this series, and we'll be in Acts chapter 3 and 4. I want to encourage you right now to get a Bible. Maybe that's a handheld device or a phone, or it's an actual paper Bible. It's a great time to go get a Bible. We're also going to take communion together today. So you might want to go to your refrigerator and get some juice and some crackers, and we will take the Lord's Supper together later in this service today. Well, we're also going to sing. In just a minute, our band's going to lead us in a song, and we want you to stand up and clap and sing along, and I'd love to read a passage from the book of Ephesians just to get us ready for that moment. In Ephesians chapter 3, at the end of that chapter, the Apostle Paul prays, and he prays that God may strengthen us with His power through His Spirit in our inner being, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And that we, being rooted and established in love, may be able to grasp with all God's people the bigness of God. And that we might know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, and that we may be filled with all the fullness of God. And then he ends this prayer with a prayer for the church when he says, now to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to that power that is at work within us, to Him be the glory in the church forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, Safe Harbor. We ask you to join us this morning from your living rooms. Only a few more weeks, hopefully, and then we get to see your faces here in person, and we can worship together as one again. But as we look forward to that day, let's worship this morning.
There is power here in this hour, we're all together, waiting here as one.
Sing it out. There is power
here in this hour, we're all together, waiting here as one.
Oh, hear the sounds from heaven. Oh, a mighty rushing wind. Oh, we're calling for revival. God, let your fire fall again. It's burning in my soul.
Oh, Good morning, Safe Harbor. This is Pastor Franklin, helping you stay in the know. We just wanted to let you know that there are many ways for you to serve. I know you've heard me say this week after week, but it's still true. You are able to serve in many areas. We are still looking for people to help with the live stream team, editing, or you don't even have to have experience in that. We can show you. Another thing that we are looking for too is that we don't know exactly when the church will be open again, but when it does open, we're going to need a sanitizing team that will come in and keep the church clean by wiping doorknobs, door handles, and things like that, so that we're all safe during this time. So consider joining our sanitation team. Another thing that we are looking for is elder care. We have room on the elder care team for you to serve. And also, a very critical and important area is the prayer team. Prayer is one of the most powerful tools that we have as believers. And we are looking for people who are willing to take on that task, to get on their knees and pray for the needs of the people of the church and also for our community. So keep that in mind as well. And then also our Calvary team, if you're interested in helping others, if you have that heart to be generous as far as helping people in need, consider joining the Calvary team as well. And that brings me to this next point, which is giving. We believe in giving sacrificially here at Safe Harbor. We want to give because Jesus gave everything he had so that we could have everything that we need. And one of the ways that we can show that same love that Jesus had for us is by taking on that same mind and giving what we have so that everyone can have what they need. So consider giving sacrificially during this time as well. And also consider giving to our Calvary team as well, because we have people who have been laid off, who have been furloughed, and they need assistance. And if we can help one another because we're family, why not do so? So consider giving a little extra to the Calvary team as well. And you can give online by going to the website, and you can click on giving, the giving link there. Or if you have the Church Center app downloaded on your phone or a mobile device, you can also give there conveniently as well. One of the things that we really believe in at Safe Harbor is small groups. Small groups is not what we do, but it's who we are. We believe in gospel-centered community. And as was said a couple of weeks ago, it takes a different type of commitment to be a part of a gospel-centered community rather compared to being a part of a casual church. And in small groups, in gospel-centered community, that's how we take care of one another. That's how we help each other mature. And so what I want you to do is I want you to take a look at a video from one of our small groups here. And Nathan Miller, he's going to show you what's going on in their small group. So let's take a look now.
Hi, Safe Harbor. My name is Nathan Miller. This is my wife, Maggie. And I just wanted to share our community group with you. It's Wednesday night and we just met and we had a great time. And I just wanted to encourage you guys, if you're not actively part of a community group right now, and you're missing out on that social interaction, I implore you to find a group to connect to. This group is very important to me. I have a friend named Dan in this group, and we share our workout pictures with each other every Thursday. And without that, I might just, there's several Dans here. And find a group so that you can meet with them and laugh with them and just love on each other. So I hope you are all staying safe and well during this time, and I can't wait to see you all again.
Thanks so much, Nathan, for that video update of your small group. Continue to do the good work. Guess what? Next week, next Sunday, is Mother's Day. Yes, that's right. It's Mother's Day. And I know that mothers everywhere love Mother's Day in the church. And we want to make that day special for you. So what we want to ask is that everyone, if you can, create a 10 to 20 second video to send a shout out to your moms and then send it in. And we're going to do a little something special with those video clips. And you can send those directly to me at franklin@safeharbor-church.org. And I guarantee you, you're going to enjoy what you see. So, that's me coming at you with the info to keep you in the know here at Safe Harbor. I'm looking forward to seeing you next week. And next up, Pastor Jeff is going to lead us through communion. Take care and be blessed.
Good morning, Safe Harbor. Pastor Jeff here. At this point, we are going to partake of communion together as one body, one heart, one spirit, even in the midst of social distancing. So before we partake of the communion elements, we are going to look at Ezekiel 34, verses 20 to 24. I'm just going to read that here. Thus says the Lord God to them, Behold, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you push with side and shoulder and thrust at all the weak with your horns, till you have scattered them abroad. I will rescue my flock. They shall no longer be a prey, and I will judge between sheep and sheep, and I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them, and he shall be their shepherd, and I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince among them. I am the Lord, I have spoken. So the prophet Ezekiel writes these words right after the fact that Israel, this once great world power, this great kingdom, was overtaken by the Babylonians, and they were taken into exile. And Ezekiel looks to a day when God, because God is faithful to his promises, to his covenant, that he will come and he will seek out Israel, seek out the lost sheep, and he will make one people for himself, and he will shepherd them, and he will give them all that they will need. And Ezekiel also writes that God will put on the throne King David, which is a weird thing to think about, because King David was a king many years before all this happened. Fast forward to 600 years, Jesus comes on the scene, declares the kingdom of God. This man who is in the royal lineage of King David and David's family, an heir to the throne, Jesus comes and he says in John 10, I am the good shepherd. I come and I seek out the sheep. The sheep know my voice. They hear me and they follow me. And Jesus says that he is the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep. No one takes his life from him, but he lays it down. And that's why his Father loves him. And so that is what communion is all about. It is remembering the body of Christ that was broken for us, the blood of Jesus that was poured out for us. It is this new life, like Jesus who has come to save us from the enemy, who comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus comes to give us life and life abundantly, life to the fullest, like life that's found in being part of the flock of God. And that's what communion is all about. So let us partake of the body and blood of Jesus. This is the body of Christ. Let us take and remember it and be thankful. And this cup is the cup of the new covenant in Christ's blood poured out for us as the sheep. Let us take and drink and remember. All right, let's pray. God, thank you so much for the fact that you're not a God who's distant, but you're a God who is like, you're a shepherd, and you've come near. And you've always been interacting with us as people, but you wanted to even come closer, and you came in the person of Jesus, an heir to King David's throne, the true king, a good king, a good shepherd king. And God, we receive your body and your blood again, and we receive the fact that we are part of your sheepfold, that we desire to follow you, and we're just so thankful that you invite us to be a part of your family, to sit at the table and to eat this meal as your family, God. We love you, God. Thank you so much for all that you've done. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I always get a kick out of sassy kids. Like, not my kids, other people's kids, your kids. It's not funny when it's my children, although my wife thought it was kind of funny. When our son was about 2 years old, his go-to phrase was, "I can't as I want to." Whatever it was, "Jonah, you can't go outside." "I can't as I want to." And Tammy, his mom, whenever he would say that, inevitably she would turn around and she would laugh, and I would say, "Babe, come on, get in the zone, in the parent zone." And I would stare Jonah down, and he would look at me. I would get down on his level and very calmly just say, "Jonah, God created you to learn from your parents. We love you. We want to teach you, and God wants you to honor mom and dad." I was so calm back then. I want to be that dad again. It's so much harder when your kids get older. If you know what I'm talking about, can I get an amen on the Facebook comments section right now? So anyway, around that time, Jonah wanted to ride a bike. He kept asking if he could ride a bike without training wheels. And his brother was 18 months older than him. He still had training wheels. And in our limited experience, a two-year-old was not ready to ride a bike without training wheels. He kept asking, and we would say, "Just wait a little bit, buddy. Just a little bit. One day we'll take off the training wheels." And he just was relentless about it. So he's about 3 years old, and we finally decide, okay, you know, he's got to learn at some time. And we just said, "You're not ready yet, buddy." But he kept saying, "I can as I want to." So finally, when we decided to take those training wheels off, we said, "All right, now you're going to need our help just to get started." He said, "I can do it all by myself. I don't need any help." And we just said, "All right, this is the moment that he's going to learn. He needs to learn now that he needs mom and dad's help. So we got to let him fail. We're going to let him do it by himself and just, you know, get the first aid kit ready, get ready to call 911. He's got to learn the hard way that he needs mom and dad's help." And so that's the day that he learned the lesson that he can as he wants to. He was fine. We let go of the seat. He took off. We thought, surely he's going to fall. He never fell. We thought, surely he's going to need our help to get back on the bike. He was too small to get on the bike freestanding, so he would lean it up against the fence and climb on board and take off again. And I don't know that every three-year-old has that same kind of bold confidence for reasons both environmental and genetic, not everyone is that confident when they're three. But I do know that spiritually, when we're just getting started on our journey as followers of Jesus, as disciples who want to give our lives for the one who gave his life for us, that there's a kind of boldness and passion and confidence and zeal that is inspiring to others. It fills us with joy as we get started. It fuels our walk with Jesus. But over time, that passion, that zeal starts to wane. That boldness and confidence has a tendency to dissipate. If you've been a part of the body of Christ for long, then you know that it is a reality of the natural development for everyone who has ever decided to put their trust in Jesus, to be baptized into him, and made this personal decision to pick up their cross and follow wherever he leads, that inevitably you lose that passion, you lose steam. That it's attested to in Scripture. Jesus tells parables about it. There's a whole book. The book of Hebrews is essentially about that problem. And in the book of Revelation, there's a letter, a note to the church in Ephesus that they do all these amazing things, but there's this criticism that Jesus has against them that they had forgotten their first love. There was something missing. Don't let this make you nervous. Don't let it shake you. This is part of growing up spiritually. But if we're not careful, then these unexpected disappointments and setbacks and overwhelming circumstances and criticism from other believers and disillusionment and prayers that aren't answered the way that we think that they should be answered, and the failure of those who are supposed to lead us, perceived judgment from outsiders, sharp judgment from insiders, temptations, moral compromise, the reality of what the Bible calls the flesh, and struggling with the same old habits over and over again, all of that begins to weigh down our childlike faith. And whether you've been a follower of Jesus for as long as you could remember, or you're just getting started, I think that there's something that we learn in Acts chapter 3 and 4 that we desperately need to remember if we're going to have this faith for the long haul. If you feel weighed down right now, if you've lost your passion, if you're confused in the dark night of your soul, if you've lost your way, or if you're contemplating Jesus for the first time, if you're setting out on this journey with passion, I think we all need to come to terms with what we discover in this passage. If we're going to be spirit-led, joy-filled followers of Jesus with a childlike faith that Jesus describes in Matthew chapter 18 and other places like that, I believe that we discover something in this passage. That there's, in fact, that's the overt theme of Acts chapters 3 and 4. So if you went to grab your Bible earlier, go ahead and open up to that passage, Acts chapter 3. Last week we started this new series. If you weren't with us last week, we encourage you to go back and check that out on YouTube. We started this new series called Now What? It's the series, we're making our way through the book of Acts, where we find that the apostles, at every turn, every time something changed, they have to ask themselves that question, now what? What do we do? And as followers of Jesus here in the 21st century who are faced with this global crisis, I think a lot of us are asking ourselves the question right now, like, now what do we do as followers of Jesus who are supposed to be the church when we can't gather together? And last week we said that this is a period of waiting, just like what we read in the book of Acts in the very beginning, that they were told to wait for the promised Holy Spirit. But when he came, it was off to the races. And I think that right now we are in this period of waiting. And last week we said that this is a time for us to pray that God would show us what it really means to be the church. This is a time for us to read Scripture and to come to terms with what it really means to be a disciple of Jesus. This is a time for us to come back, to understand what it means to really be committed as followers of Christ. As Pastor Franklin said a few weeks ago, that gospel-centered community requires a deeper level of commitment than casual church. And so as we contemplate this together, our hope and as our expectation is that we come back with a zeal, with a passion, with a renewed desire to be the church, not just go to church, but to be followers of Jesus who are unleashing the gospel together. And I think that Acts chapter 3 and 4 is very instructive for us if we are going to have this kind of passion and zeal that goes the distance. So check this out. We're going to back up to the beginning in chapter 3 in just a minute, but I want to skip ahead to chapter 4. And so here, at this point in the story, in this episode, Peter and John have caused a stir in the city. They've healed a man who was lame, who was unable to walk since the time he was born. So at this point in chapter 4, the apostles are standing in something like the Supreme Court, but it has a religious tone to it. It is the Jewish high court, the Sanhedrin. There's 72 people that make up this court. There's 24 chief priests, not just priests, but chief priests, 24 elders who were reputable men, and 24 people of the scribes. They were teachers of the law. These were the guys who studied God's word and said, this is what God's word means. So in chapter 4, verse 7, it's kind of a lengthy passage, but it's a story. The book of Acts is a story, and it just kind of flows. So I'm going to read at least through verse 14 and summarize a little bit and skip down to verses 19 and 21. Here's what we read there in verse 7. Here we go. And when they had set them in the midst, they inquired, by what power and by what name did you do this? Did you heal this person? So Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, as we saw last week, Peter's filled with the Spirit, and he says, rulers of the people and elders, if we're being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means has this man been healed, then let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, who God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else. There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Verse 13. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated common men, they were astonished and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. Then we go on to read that they wanted to do something about it, but they realized that this man was indeed healed, and he was standing there right there with them, and everybody knew who this guy was, and they came to the realization that they couldn't throw these men in jail. The city would revolt. So they said, go away for a little bit and let us discuss it. And while they were discussing it, they decided that they were going to tell them when they came back that they should not teach in the name of Jesus anymore. They shouldn't even mention his name. So verse 18, they called them back in. They charged them not to teach at all in the name of Jesus. Verse 19, but Peter and John answered them, hey, listen, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than him, you must judge. For we cannot speak of what we have seen, and heard. And when they had further threatened them, this is a pretty funny note to me, they just threatened them some more, and then they let them go because they couldn't do anything. This guy was indeed healed. So the thing that's often mentioned here is that these uneducated men are articulating the truth of Scripture in a way that is surprising to these religious leaders. But what I now notice, this scarlet thread running through chapter 3, 4, and even chapter 5, is not simply that they're articulate. Not simply that they're saying things that are insightful about God's word. What I notice here, what I think caught the attention of the Sadducees, of the scribes, of the teachers of the law, the chief priests, the elders, is that Peter and John were bold. They were confident. Where did that come from? See, Peter and John, not only were they not educated, they were not supposed to know a lot about Scripture. And when they're arrested, the reason they're arrested is that they're teaching in the temple. And the people who take note of this are the Sadducees. There's a note, actually, in chapter 4, verse 2, as to what exactly bothered them. So these people had the audacity, Peter and John had the audacity to teach the Bible to people. And the Sadducees, they were kind of like the educated, liberal, well-to-do class. They were at odds with the Pharisees. They disagreed with the Pharisees, but at least the Pharisees were well-educated. Here, these men had no education, and they were assuming the role of a teacher. Not only that, but they also were saying that Jesus had been resurrected. Now, the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection. They didn't believe that in life after death. And the way that you can remember that, the mnemonic device that was given to me was that the Sadducees were sad, you see, for they did not believe in the resurrection. But here Peter and John were assuming the role of a teacher. They were teaching the people, and they had no credentials. They had no education. Who do they think they were? Not only that, they are teaching about life after death, and that Jesus, in the person of Jesus, they were talking about the resurrection. And so they weren't able to arrest them that day, but they arrested them later, and they brought them into the court. Compare what we just read with what we find at the end of the Gospels in John chapter 20, verse 19. There we find this scene where the disciples were hiding in the upper room, and they locked the door because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders. But here, not only are they not afraid, they are declaring the truth about who Jesus is, and even when they're threatened, even when they're told not to speak in that name, they can't help it. They have this boldness, and I wonder where that boldness comes from. Verse 13 tells us that they recognized that these men had been with Jesus. So here's what I think the theme of these chapters is. Here's the big idea, and this has spoke to my heart this week. It has given me boldness and confidence. My hope is that it does the same for all of us, that as we, in this time of waiting, that we might come to an appreciation for what Peter and John had experienced, so that when we come back with a devotion to Jesus beyond what we had before, that we're not content with casual church, that we just want to be followers of Jesus who pick up our cross and follow Him and speak the truth of who He is, that no matter what happens, we're not going to stop speaking about Jesus. So here's what gives them that boldness. They have been with Jesus. So the big idea today is that true confidence for Jesus comes from spending time with Jesus. If we're going to be bold for Jesus, if we're going to speak the truth of the gospel, if we're going to unleash the gospel, it's not going to come from just showing up to church and singing songs and listening to a sermon, or even being a part of a small group that eats dinner together. I mean, I think that that will be satisfying. I think that it will encourage us. But here at Safe Harbor, we want to unleash the gospel. We want people to know the name of Jesus. We want people to see Him as the risen King and to know that He's the one who sets things right, who puts things back the way that they're supposed to be. We want people to be followers of Jesus, not just part of our community. And I think that we can have that if we will make time for Jesus on a daily basis, if we will spend time with Him, if we will pick up our cross and follow Him, if we will walk with Jesus, if we want to be these joy-filled, spirit-led, passionate followers of Jesus with a childlike faith that's infectious, that spreads. Let me choose a different metaphor. If we want to live out a way of life that causes people to take note, not note of us, not to take note of anything about us, but to take note of Jesus, the one that we keep coming back to, the name that we proclaim. If we want that, then I think we can discover in here a couple of hints as to what exactly it was about Jesus that these apostles, these disciples saw in Him, and how that translated to action for them. And so let's back up just a little bit. Chapter 3, here's how the episode gets started. Act 3, scene 1. Peter and John enter the temple courts, and there's this guy there who had been lame since birth. And he was being carried by his friends. His friends would carry him to the temple daily and set him down at the gate called Beautiful, at the Beautiful Gate. We don't know exactly where that was, but it was a prominent place with lots of traffic. So he sits there and he is asking people for charity as people come back and forth. There was no hospitals back then. People relied on the charity of strangers. Hospitals, by the way, are an invention of Christianity, of the church, who just a few centuries later would see this as an expression of the gospel. But at this point, people would just ask for charity of strangers passing by. So Peter and John are passing by. This man looks at them and says, "Alms for the poor." And Peter and John lock eyes with him. So Peter says, "I don't have any money, but I'll give you what I have." In the name, he says, check this out, verse 6. "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the hand and raised him up. Now freeze right there. Pause right there. What is Peter thinking in that moment when he says, "Get up and walk"? I think we've all been there to a certain degree where we say something really bold and we're not sure what's going to happen after the fact. What is Peter thinking? Where does he get that confidence? Where does he get that boldness? Now, in the Gospels, in the four books that record the story of who Jesus is, they all portray Peter as this guy who has a tendency to act before he thinks. This is the guy who sees Jesus walking on the water towards him. And he says, "Jesus, if it's you, tell me to get out of the boat and I'll walk to you." And he does. He gets out of the boat and he starts walking towards Jesus. But the moment he takes his eyes off Jesus, he sees the wind and the waves and he gets afraid and he starts to drown, right? This is the guy who has a tendency to take action and then realize, "Oh no, what have I done? So maybe Peter is just the guy to do this. But all of that takes boldness and confidence. See, Jesus has healed people before. That was Jesus. And these are the guys who walked with him for 3 years. This statement, "Get up and walk in the name of Jesus," is the most natural thing they could do. See, Jesus had said to them in John chapter 16, verse 23, he says, "Look, there's a day coming when I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. I'm going to send the Comforter. And you'll no longer ask me for anything. But I tell you the truth, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Whatever you speak in my name, my Father will do it." Now, until now, he says, verse 24, "You've not asked for anything in my name, but ask and you will receive and your joy will be complete." And so maybe they remember that. Whatever the case may be, the consistent theme from here on out is the name of Jesus. Whenever they have an opportunity, they speak the name of Jesus. Jesus didn't heal everyone. So there was some occasions in the Gospels where he was not able to heal because of people's lack of faith. And I imagine that there were people who he passed by on occasion, but sometimes he would lock eyes with the person who was in need of healing, and he was willing. Jesus was willing to give healing to people. And Peter and John knew that if they asked in the name of Jesus, that it was God's will to heal this man. And so they said, "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk." Have you ever started to pray for something and then like backed off because you thought it was too big? It was too bold? Like what would happen if it didn't come true? A couple months ago, before all this this crisis in the world, a dear brother in Christ, Eddie Levy, was here in church with us, and he was not feeling well. So he got up and he walked out the back doors and he collapsed on the way out. None of us knew what was happening at the time, but his wife sprung into action. She came through the doors and she said, "Is there an ambulance?" And this is a little bit traumatic for people. This is not something that I've seen in 16 years of preaching. I had not experienced that before. It's pretty uncommon, I think, for that to happen in a church service. Usually it happens before or after, or it's out in a place where it gets handled. But she came in the door. She said, "Is there somebody who can call an ambulance? Is there a doctor? Is there a nurse?" She apologized later for that. Listen, if you fall and collapse in church, ask for people to pray for you. Ask for people to spring into action. That's what we're going to do. We're a family. And so that's actually what we did. We stopped the service, and we just brought it to a close, and I prayed. Now, Eddie had a few surgeries recently, just before this happened. And I was pretty sure that he had a heart attack. So as we prayed, I found myself saying out loud, Father, we ask you in the name of Jesus to revive our brother. And as I was saying the words, I was asking myself, did I really mean that? Did I really want to say it? Like in my own private time, no big deal. I'm with Jesus now. I'm a follower of Jesus. And so I trust him with my prayers. Sometimes he says no. Sometimes what I'm asking for is not what's good for me. He knows that, and I trust him with the outcome. But in a room full of people who are at various points in their walk with Jesus, in their faith, that was a risky move. Like, what if God didn't answer that prayer? How would other people respond? Well, as I concluded the prayer, I remember saying something about, Jesus, you are the author of life, and we trust you to give life to our brother. And so I was so relieved to find out as we were leaving the auditorium that he was conscious in the ambulance on his way to the hospital. Look, Jesus came to heal, to set things right. And I'm not saying that we need to be faith healers. What I am saying is that the confidence that Peter and John had in that moment to say, get up and walk in the name of Jesus, came from the time that they spent with Jesus. They had this confidence that Jesus came to heal. And the reason they knew that is that they actually walked with him. And so, look, we can't have the same face-to-face experience that Peter and John had. But we can read the Gospels. We can read the life of Christ. We can read about who he was and what he did. And we can spend time in prayer, and we can read the rest of this book. Sometimes we hear directly from Jesus in it. Sometimes we're being told about who Jesus is. But we can learn who Jesus is, who he really is, what he really wants for you and me if we will take the time to read his word and to pray and to allow the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Christ, to lead us. See, I think that Peter and John knew that this was a moment to say to this man, in the name of Jesus Christ, get up and walk. And I'm making an assumption here, but I've had that experience where that's not always the prayer to pray. To always pray that prayer that, you know, is about the thing that's the immediate need. But other times it is. Like, and I can't explain how, just being led by the Spirit of God, learning to know what God wants, comes from spending time in his word, comes from listening to that still small voice, learning to follow Jesus. And Peter and John knew in that moment, this was the thing that they're supposed to say. In the name of Jesus, get up and walk. Timothy Keller, in his book, The Reason for God, it's a little bit older at this point, but there's a note there about miracles that I think is brilliant. Now, this is what he says. He says, we modern people think of miracles as a suspension of the natural order, but Jesus meant them to be the restoration of the natural order. The Bible tells us that God did not make the world to have disease and hunger and death in it. Jesus has come to redeem where it is wrong and to heal the world where it is broken. His miracles are not just proof that he has powerful, but also wonderful foretastes of what he is going to do with that power. Jesus' miracles are not just a challenge for our minds, they are a promise to our hearts that the world we want and all that we want is coming. In other words, we have a hard time believing miracles because our starting point is that the world as it is the world as it is intended to be, as it's supposed to be. But the creator of this world, Jesus, came to redeem it and restore it, to restore the reality of the world that he created, to put it back right. And so when he does what he does, he's not violating the natural order. He's restoring the natural order. And we were meant to live our lives in this connection with God. And while the reality of sin and death and brokenness is all around us, that isn't the life that we were intended to live. That isn't the life that Jesus wants for us. He is the Redeemer. He is the Healer. He is the Restorer. And Peter and John know that. They believe that Jesus would heal this man because they spent time with Jesus. And so they're led by the Spirit of God to do this bold thing. The thing that Peter and John learned as they spent time with Jesus is that he is a healer. It turns out in Acts chapter 19, there's a group of guys who try to do something similar. There's a man who's possessed by demons, and they try to cast out those demons in the name of Jesus. They invoke the name of Jesus, and they end up getting beat up by that man in the process. And the difference between Peter and John and these guys in Acts chapter 19 is that they hadn't been with Jesus. They didn't really know Jesus. They wanted Jesus to do something through them. They wanted to accomplish something. They wanted to prove themselves. They wanted to invoke the name of Jesus, but it wasn't coming from a time spent with Jesus. Stick with me here. It's about to get real. See, sometimes when we ask God to do something, it's not about what God wants, it's about what we want. It's about glory for us. It's about bringing attention to ourselves. It's about expecting God to do a certain thing because we assume that that certain thing is what God wants for us. But Peter and John have a deeper understanding of who Jesus is and what he desires. They've walked with him. So they're not arrogant. They're not bringing attention to themselves. They want people to know the name of Jesus. And that's exactly what happens next. Resume the story. The man, at that point, that Peter reaches out and says, in the name of Jesus, get up and walk. His ankles are strengthened. He gets up, and get this. He doesn't just start walking. He is walking and leaping and praising God. Now, everybody knew this guy because he had been sitting at the temple day after day after day, and they are all amazed. So a crowd starts gathering around. They gather around Peter and John because this guy is standing next to Peter and John in what is called Solomon's portico, according to verse 11 in chapter 3. And so Peter speaks up. Check this out, verse 12. Peter saw this crowd, and he said, "Men of Israel, why do you wonder at this? Why do you stare at this as though by our own power or piety we've made this man walk?" Check it out. Like Peter's saying, this is not because we're good people. We have asked Jesus to do this, and he did it in his name. God the Father did it because of the name of Jesus, because Jesus wanted it to happen. It's not because we're especially righteous. It's not because we're good. It's because Jesus wanted to do it. Verse 13, "So the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our forefathers, glorified his servant Jesus." Not us, but Jesus, "who you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate when he decided to release him. But you denied the holy and righteous one and asked for a murderer to be granted to you, and you killed the author of life, who God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses, and by his name, by faith in his name, this man was made strong, whom you now see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given this man perfect health in the presence of all of you." So he goes on. "Brothers and sisters," he says, "I know you acted in ignorance, but all of this happened was not really about you or me. It wasn't about us. It was about God, who made a promise. He made a promise in the very beginning. He foretold by the mouth of all the prophets that this Christ would suffer. And it's happened. He suffered. He died on the cross. So repent," he says, "turn back so that your sins may be forgiven, may be blotted out, and that times of refreshing might come to you." Now check this out, verse 20. And "that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, who heaven must receive until the time for restoring all things,
about which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. Then he goes on to say, more scripture here. He says, Moses said that the Lord will raise up from you a prophet like me from among your brothers. In other words, he will be human. He will be one of us. You shall listen to him, whatever he tells you. And it shall be that whoever does what he does not listen to him, to that prophet will be destroyed from the people. And all the prophets who have spoken from Samuel and all those prophets who came after him proclaim these days. Now, you are the sons of the prophets, he says. Like, you are people who know what the prophets have said. And you know the covenant that God made with our forefathers, with Abraham, that that through him everyone would be blessed. So now turn from your wickedness. And he even refers to Jesus in this passage. He refers to him not just as the Christ, but as the Christ of God, the Christ, God's Christ. In other words, this promised Messiah isn't just about people who need to be rescued. It's the promise that God made from the very beginning that he would redeem his creation. And so here's the point. Here's what Peter and John learned about Jesus from walking with him. And you'll remember last week that they were that Jesus had opened their mind to understand the scriptures. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. Whenever they spoke the truth of who Jesus was and articulated scripture and showed that Jesus was the fulfillment of those scriptures. What they knew about Jesus was that he was the Messiah, the Christ, the Savior of the world. Now, when we think of that word Savior, when we think of being saved, we tend to think of being saved from death, from sin, from judgment, from hell. But the word salvation, the word saved in the New Testament is so much bigger than that. It encompasses that to a certain degree, but it's a lot bigger than that. Really, the word means to be made whole, to be healed, to be restored, and it implies redemption. It implies setting things right. In other words, what they understood about Jesus is that he came as the fulfillment of this promise to not just heal sickness and disease, but to set everything right, to heal the whole person. Not just to answer our prayers when we're sick, not just to cure colds, not just to hear us when we pray for the people who we love who have fallen ill. He came to restore people, body, soul, and spirit. He came to restore the whole person, to help us become who we were created to be. I love Safe Harbor. I love our church. There are countless stories in this family of people who were living a certain way, who were caught up in a certain cycle of addiction of some kind, or selfishness, or anger, spinning their wheels, and they gave their life to Jesus. And there are more stories than I can count of people who had encountered Jesus, understood his grace, and were healed. And sometimes there's starts and stops. I mean, that's part of almost every story that I can think of, that there's some back and forth, but ultimately they're a different person. They are being restored, being healed. They are being filled by the Spirit of God. They are a different person. See, what it means to say that Jesus is Messiah, the Christ, is to say that he came to redeem and restore all creation, including you and me. Not just to answer some prayers that we have from time to time, but wherever he is king, wherever he is Lord, he sets things right. He restores, he redeems, he brings about redemption and healing. He saves. I remember when I was younger that I was really excited to share my faith with a friend of mine. I think I was in seventh grade, and my junior high Sunday school teacher told me, and I don't remember exactly what she really said, but what I remember her saying was that Christianity had never been disproved and you can trust in Jesus. So I was really excited about that. And she might have mentioned some reasons why that was the case, but those were out of my mind. So I remember I was hanging out with my friend. We were playing guitar. We were listening to, I think, Frank Black of the Pixies. And I said, I don't remember what led to the conversation, but I said, you know what? Christianity has never been disproved. You can trust Jesus. To which he replied, how do you know? And I said, well, it's just true. And I was so embarrassed. And I didn't know what to say. And I think that moment, from that moment forward, I decided that I'm going to be a lot more careful about sharing my faith. Now, by the grace of God, by the mercy of God, he has helped me understand how to give an answer when somebody asks you about the hope that you have within. He has helped me to see a better way of communicating the bigness and the beauty of the gospel and how to see where that fits in a person's life, or rather how a person fits into that story that they were created for. But that moment taught me that if you want to be cool, if you want people to trust you, you got to be careful about sharing the gospel. See, what happens over time, if we have enough of those experiences, if leaders let us down in the church, if the church lets us down, if we experience criticism and disillusionment, if God doesn't answer our prayer, if we think we know what God wants for us, but it's really about us trying to prove ourselves, eventually, that flame that burns so bright gets a little dimmer. And we're hesitant to get overly emotional or excited, afraid to say the wrong thing, afraid to pray something that's too big. And we just become bland, boring people who crave the comfort of a church experience more than we want to pick up our cross and follow Jesus wherever he leads. In our small group this past week, Nathan Miller said that he thinks that all of us are just constantly reliving the first day of junior high over and over again spiritually. Go back in your mind to that day. You show up and you don't know anything. And you're concerned about who's popular and sitting with the right kids. And you don't know your way around campus. And everything is so confusing. Your body's doing weird things. Nothing is the way that you remember. Everything was so solid, and now just everything has changed. And maybe your faith feels like that right now. Just everything is confusing. I have really good news. Jesus is not just a healer. He's a savior. He wants to restore our jaded hearts. He wants to overcome our disillusionment. See, Jesus doesn't just want childish followers. He wants childlike followers. A mentor of mine told me about a book that he read years ago called The Conscious Life by Francis and Lewis Cox. It's really not all that significant, but there's a concept in there that has resonated with me ever since he shared it with me. He said, one of the things that the authors of that book talk about when they describe emotional maturity is that children by nature are unconsciously dependent, unconsciously curious, unconsciously spontaneous, and unconsciously intimate. Like, they will walk to someone and hug them. And all of that is just something that they do by nature. And the goal of maturity is not so much to be done with those things, but to do them consciously. To be consciously dependent, to be consciously curious, to be consciously spontaneous, and consciously intimate. I think a really good example that all of us can relate to is like a child is naturally curious and they want to touch the stove. And mom and dad say, don't touch the stove, but they're just curious. They have to explore the world. They have to learn about the world. And so they might touch the stove. And when you do that, you burn your hand and you learn. You learn your lesson. Don't touch the stove. And enough of those experiences happen, and you learn that it's not okay to be curious. It's not okay to be dependent. It's not okay to be spontaneous. It's not okay to be intimate. And the process of maturity is about learning to overcome the disillusionment and consciously choose those things. I think that's what Jesus is getting at when he says that we have to have a faith like a child if we want to enter into the kingdom, if we want to live the life that he's calling us to live out. And so the good news is that the Messiah, the Savior, came to unravel all of those things that have left an imprint on us, left a mark on us. He came to heal the wounds in our soul. He came to restore our hearts, to restore our soul. He's raised our spirit to life. He has caused us to be born again. He's made us new, and he wants us to believe that. So if you've wandered away, if you've lost the childlike wonder, he came to help you dream again, to live again, to believe again, to trust him again. Look, I don't think anybody's convinced to follow Jesus because we are good people who always get it right and never fail. I believe that what the world wants to see is real people with real struggles, who have a past, who sometimes have big questions and wrestle with their faith, but people who keep coming back to Jesus and in him discover joy and life and healing and restoration and, yes, confidence and boldness that comes from spending time with him, walking with him, obeying him, going where he leads. That's Peter's story. See, Peter, you might be familiar. Peter is the one who denies Jesus. Who, when Jesus is crucified and is asked, hey, aren't you one of his followers? Three times he says no. As Franklin reminded us a few weeks ago, hear the cock-a-doodle-doo, and it caused him to remember that Jesus said that was going to happen. He failed. But at the end of the book of John, in chapter 21, we read that Jesus restored Peter. He reminded him that he still loved Peter. He still chose him to be a leader to feed his sheep. And that's exactly what happens. It's not the last time Peter's going to fail. And I just believe that Peter, for all of his boldness and confidence, has to keep coming back to Jesus every day. Has to keep reminding himself that Jesus loves him every day. Has to keep picking up his cross daily and following Jesus. And every time he gets off track, and every time he fails, and every time he wrestles a little bit, every day the mercies are new, and he follows Jesus again. See, what we see by the end of this story, it blows my mind. It's not just that Peter and John see Jesus for who he is. It's that all of these believers who have gathered after Peter and John are released, they gather together and they pray this prayer, and it's about 5,000 believers, we're told, who've gathered together, and this is their prayer, verse 24, chapter 4. Sovereign Lord, who made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them, who through the mouth of our father David, your servant, said by the Holy Spirit, why do the Gentiles rage and the people plot in vain? The kings of earth set themselves up, and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord, against his anointed. For truly in this city were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, who you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, together with all the Gentiles and the people of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan predestined to take place. Now, Lord, look upon their threats and grant your servants, get ready for this, to continue to speak your word with boldness, while you stretch out your hand and heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. And when they prayed, when they were gathered together, the whole place was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And they continued to speak the word of God with boldness. Can you imagine that? After having been threatened and told not to speak the name of Jesus again, their response was to pray, Lord, help us to be bold, to continue to be bold, to not give up. We believe that you're a healer and a redeemer, that you set things right. And so what these believers saw in Jesus, what Peter and John saw in Jesus, was not just that he was a healer and a savior, but that he was king of the universe, Lord over all. Because where Jesus is king, he sets things right. We've come to believe that here at Safe Harbor, that what it means to unleash the gospel is to proclaim the reign of Jesus, that where he is Lord, where people receive him and allow him to be king of their life, things are set right. Whether that's when we go out to feed the homeless together, or we bring meals to a school, or we just show up in a restaurant together and build relationships with the people there, or we serve people with special needs, whatever it may be, where Jesus is king, he sets things right. And we could have a tendency to back off of those things in fear that people may not respond appropriately, may not believe. But I really believe that if we will choose in this time to daily make time for Jesus, to read his word, to consider his commands and obey them, not just because we're being told to do something, but because we believe that he's worth following, to commune with him and pray, that when we return, we could all come back with a renewed zeal and boldness and passion that goes the distance. To be followers of Jesus for the long haul. To return to our first love and to live for him with all that we are. And here's the crazy promise of Scripture. This audacious invitation that we are invited to boldly come into the presence of God because Jesus made a way. That we can come with confidence into his presence and ask what we need, and know that we are loved by him. So here's the invitation. Would you join us daily over the next couple weeks as we get closer and closer to reopening our campus and gathering again? Would you daily make it a habit to draw near to God boldly, with confidence, knowing that he loves you? And would you commune with Jesus? Learn from him. Read his word. And choose to go wherever he leads. I want to invite you to do that with us. On Wednesday this week, I want to share what that's been like in my life. And I would love it if at the live update on Wednesday at 7, you might share there your experience. How have you encountered Jesus? How have you discovered a more clear picture of Jesus as a healer or a savior, a redeemer, king of the universe? Well, I want to invite you to not follow me, but to follow Jesus. I believe that when that happens, we will be a church that lives out the gospel with a kind of boldness that cannot be shaken and causes people to take notice not of us, but of Jesus. Thank you.
Well, we're so glad that you've joined us. If you have kids, we want to encourage you to tune in on our Facebook page for Pastor Franklin and the So-and-So Show. A reminder that you can give at safeharbor-church.org/give. And don't forget that next week is Mother's Day. Send us those videos, 10 to 20 second videos, to franklin@safeharbor-church.org. Well, at Safe Harbor, we envision a community for everyone. We don't want to be all things to all people, but we do want everyone to find their place in gospel-centered community where they can discover who they really are. Safe Harbor, let's be bold. Let's not be arrogant or overconfident or closed off to the truth, but let's be bold. Let's unleash the gospel.